Well, it's hello again from Pastor Mark of the Norfolk and Norwich Hospital and Cromer Hospital Chaplaincy. Welcome to our time of reflection and worship. I have my good friend and colleague, Reverend Rosemary Houghton, with me to share with us. We have Johnny, Kerry and Amy to sing to us. Kerry is a ward manager on one of our wards here at the Norfolk and Norwich Hospital. And I've also invited my friends Maureen and Angie to lead us in prayer a little later in our programme. What a joy to be with you again. I think we're in for a time of encouragement. On Wednesday evening, I was on the promenade at Cromer, where I live, and I enjoyed the high tide splashing over the sea wall as the sun set in the sea towards the west. And at the same time, the full moon was rising out of the sea in the east. The sky was a mix of blues and orange and pink. The scene was beautiful. Well, I think the psalmist has noticed scenes like this before, and it's caused him to sing the praises of God, our Creator. His words are written in Psalm 19. The psalmist writes, "The heavens proclaim the glory of God. The skies display his craftsmanship. Day after day they continue to speak. Night after night they make him known. They speak without a sound or word. Their voice is never heard. Yet their message has gone throughout the earth, and their words to all the world. God has made a home in the heavens for the sun. It bursts forth like a radiant bridegroom after his wedding. It rejoices like a great athlete eager to run the race. The sun rises at one end of the heavens and follows its course to the other end. Nothing can hide from its heat." The psalmist speaks of the beauty of creation, declaring the majesty of God. Well, Stuart Townend is going to sing to us at this point, and he's going to sing "Creation Sings."
Creation sings the Father's song. He calls the sun to wake the dawn and run the course of day till evening falls in crimson rays. His fingerprints and flakes of snow, his breath upon the spinning globe. He charts the eagle's flight, commands the newborn baby cry. Hallelujah! Let all creation stand and sing. Hallelujah! Fill the earth with songs of worship. Tell the wonders of creation's King. Gazed upon his face, the ageless one in time's embrace, unveiled the Father's plan of reconciling God and man. The second Adam walked the earth, whose blameless life would break the curse, whose death would set us free to live with him eternally. Stand and sing. Hallelujah. Fill the earth with songs of worship. Tell the wonders of creation's King. Creation longs for his return, when Christ shall reign upon the earth. The bitter wars that rage are birth pains of a coming age. When he renews the land and sky, all heaven will sing and earth reply. With long resplendent theme, the
And that was Creation's Song by Stuart Townend. A beautiful hymn, I think you'll agree. I'm really pleased to welcome my friend and fellow chaplain, Reverend Rosemary Houghton, today. She's come to read to us from the Gospels and has come to share a few thoughts. So good morning, Rosemary. It's great to see you this morning. And let's hear what you have to bring to us.
Good morning, Mark. Good morning, everyone. Our reading this morning is from Luke 15, beginning at verse 11, and it's the parable of the lost son. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired men have had food to spare, and here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you, and I am no more longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And so they began to celebrate."
We all know this story, don't we, in Luke's Gospel. It's about relationships, self-discovery and forgiveness. The relationship between the father and the sons, and the relationship between the two brothers. The self-discovery is the realization by the younger brother of what he has thrown away by his selfishness, not wanting to wait, but wanting everything now. The forgiveness is complete. No recriminations. No, you can come home if... Just a joyous welcome and complete forgiveness. How many of us can say we've have been that forgiving when someone's wronged us? Oh, we may say, "I forgive you," but then harbour in our hearts all the hurt or the rejection at the times, bring to mind and dwell on it, and perhaps even throw it back in someone's face. In Matthew 18:21, we read that Jesus said we should always forgive, not just 7 times, but 77 times. Jesus forgave his persecutors from the cross. He was an innocent man, but took on the sins of all mankind. We are human and sometimes find it hard to forgive and forget, but if we can, our lives and relationships with those around us will be enriched because of the love we show. Now, if we read further on in chapter 15 of Luke, we see how the eldest son is eaten up with anger and loses out on the bond he had with his father because he just could not forgive or forget the perceived injustice. As in our reading, the father was so joyful to have his younger son back. He must have also been sad at his oldest son's reaction. If you have children, this story will resonate as sibling rivalries play out, especially in these unprecedented times when families in lockdown are together all day, every day. But the important message is, whatever happens, whatever is said or done, forgiveness is the key. Just as the Father forgives us, we must forgive others. Amen.
Thanks, Rosemary. I don't know about you, I love these stories that Jesus told, all the parables and the stories from the time as he walked on this earth, with people like you and me. I wonder, Rosemary, when you read this story of the parable of the lost son, do you see yourself anywhere in this story?
Yes, I do, Mark. I see myself not only in the parent forgiven a child, but I also see myself in the eldest son. As when I was younger, growing up, not feeling as valued as my brother was. And yes, I can see myself there too. So, but I know that my Heavenly Father, He values me. And I've learned that as I've grown older. And it's a great consolation.
Many of us have a picture, don't we, of a family that's meant to be perfect, and it doesn't live up to reality all the time, does it? We've all got our flaws. Rosemary, I see myself in this story also as the son that went astray. You know, I was 19 before I came to faith, and I wasn't living a way that God would want me to live. And what I found, the wonder is that he said I could just come to him as I am. I didn't have to try and clean my ways up or anything, but just come to him and say, I want to live your way now. And in doing that, I found the forgiveness of God. And the forgiveness that you talk about in this story, it does make you feel valued, doesn't it? And certainly the enormous sense of freedom from guilt that I found was overwhelming. Can you testify to that at all?
Most definitely, Mark. I can relate to that in my own life. I was brought up quite strictly in the Catholic religion, but never really found Jesus until I'd gone away and come back again. And the forgiveness he gave me, my life started me off anew and on a different path, and helped me to be a lot more understanding in my forgiveness of others, because I must admit to being quite judgmental when I was younger. But I've learned, and Jesus has taught me in my walk in faith, not to be judgmental, but just to be thankful for relationships and be forgiving, because I know how many times people have forgiven me in my life.
The joy and wonder of forgiveness. Actually, when we're forgiven, it's almost as if, well, it is, isn't it, Rosemary? Somebody's given us a gift. But forgiveness, when it's placed in our hands and ours to give, we've got to remember, maybe can also be the greatest gift that we can give to somebody else. Doesn't it diffuse situations and set people free? It's like pouring oil on troubled waters. It's great to be with you today, Rosemary. Maybe you just like to say goodbye to our listeners, whoever they are and wherever they may be.
Yes, thank you, Mark, for giving me the opportunity to share with you this morning's thoughts on forgiveness. And I never ever forget watching television and watching that man who lost his daughter during the uprisings in Ireland, and how he forgave them. He'd lost his most precious gift, but he forgave them. And I think that's something that we need. It's very humbling, but that's something that we need to cling on to. So as we go out into another week, unknown, we don't know where we're going to be, what we're going to be doing. But I think the main thing to remember is that we have been forgiven. And I think the gift of forgiveness is a wonderful thing.
I always enjoy being with Rosemary. She's always an encouragement to me. Our next song then this morning is going to tell us how much God loves you and me. The song is How Deep the Father's Love for Us.
Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. In Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain? Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Your wounds have paid my ransom.
Well, it's our time to pray again, and we have an invitation in Scripture which says, come now, let's reason together. I think those words are lovely. They're found in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18, and it's God inviting us to come and reason with him. Again, in Scripture it says, come boldly before the throne of God. There's a reminder not to fear as we come into his presence to pray, but to come believing that he hears. He's ready to answer, and nothing is too difficult for him. Well, I said earlier in our broadcast, I've invited my friends Maureen Moore and Angie Bennett from Carlton Road Baptist Church to lead our prayers today. And when we've had those prayers from Maureen and Angie, Johnny, Kerry and Amy will lead us in a song, Because He Lives.
Dear Lord, we thank you for this day, a day set aside to worship and praise you. With the coronavirus at the forefront of everything we do and churches closed, it is so good that we have the radio and television and other ways to still communicate and share your word. We know, Lord, that you are in control. We pray for all those that are sick and suffering. We ask for your healing touch to be upon them. We ask for your spirit to move through this land, that people would turn to you in this crisis. Amen.
Lord, during this time of lockdown, we come to you. We ask, where is this virus? Something we cannot see, but is ravaging through the world. We turn to you more and more, and know that love never fails, even in the darkest moments. Love gives us hope, It compels us to fight against the virus. Love commands us to stand together, and as we pray in our own homes around the world, we are united as one family. Lord, only you know. Amen.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Have ever climbed a mountain? We don't have too many of those in Norfolk, do we? Do you know, it takes a lot of effort, and mountains have this horrible habit of just when you think you're nearly at the top, you're reaching the pinnacle, and you get to that point where you think you've reached the top, and then you see there's another long stretch of mountain ahead of you, and you've got another climb to do. Eventually you reach the summit, and the views can be really rewarding and breathtaking. There's a hill in Cromer which I like to stand on and overlook the town, and and the pier below. It always stirs me to pray for my town. I feel very close to God there. Somebody once called that kind of place a thin place, where the distance between ourselves and God doesn't seem very far at all. In the Bible, God is thought of as God of the high places by Israel's enemies, but they soon find out he's also God in the valleys. In life, the good times are referred to as mountain peaks, aren't they? And when things are tough or go wrong, we're said to be down in the valleys, or sometimes we say down in the dumps. I've got a song that I want you to enjoy and listen to this morning. It's by Linda Randall. It's called God of the Mountain. And it reminds us that, yes, God is on the mountain. But when we're in the darkness and in the difficult place in the valleys, God is still God and he's still with us.
Life is easy when you're up on the mountain, and you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But things change when you're down in the valley. Don't lose faith, for you're never alone. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, he'll make them right. Still God in the night. You talk of faith when you're up on the mountain, but talk comes so easy when life's at its best. Now it's down in the valley, trials and temptations, that's where your faith is really put to the test. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go
this week I'd leave you with a heavenly thought and view today. In the book of Revelation, John is given a glorious vision of the throne room of God. We see that he doesn't sit in isolation, but God is surrounded by creatures and elders and angels. I love the scene, and when I feel low or my faith is weak, I often imagine what it will be like to stand here before the Lord when I pass from life to glory. Let me read to you some verses from Revelation chapter 4 and chapter 5. These are words of John the evangelist. After this I looked, and there before me was a door standing open in heaven. And the voice I had first heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, "Come up here, and I will show you what must take place." At once I was in the Spirit, and there before me was a throne in heaven with someone sitting on it, and the one who sat there had the appearance of jasper and ruby. A rainbow that shone like an emerald encircled the throne. Surrounding the throne were 24 other thrones, and seated on them were 24 elders. They were dressed in white and had crowns of gold upon their heads. From the throne came flashes of lightning, rumblings and peals of thunder. In front of the throne were seven lamps, which were blazing. They are the seven spirits of God. Also in front of the throne was what looked like a sea of glass, clear as crystal. In the centre and around the throne were four living creatures. Day and night they never stopped saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." Whenever the living creatures give glory, honour and thanks to him who sits on the throne and who lives for ever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne, and they worship him who lives for ever and ever. They lay their crowns before the throne and they say, "You are worthy, O Lord our God, to receive glory and honour and power. For you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being." Then I saw a lamb, looking as if it had been slain, standing at the centre of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the elders. Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. And in a loud voice they were saying, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honour and glory and praise." Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and on the sea, and all that is in them, saying, "To him who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb, be praise and honour and glory and power for ever and ever." The four living creatures said, "Amen." And the elders fell down, and they worshipped again. Oh, what a scene of glory and splendour. I want to leave you with that scene fresh in your mind. And as I do so, I pray that the Lord our God will bless you and keep you, that he may turn his face towards you and be gracious to you and give you peace. Amen. I hope you have a great week. This is Pastor Mark saying thank you for joining us again and goodbye. And I'm going to leave you with a song that is called "There Is a Higher Throne." Goodbye for now.
each tear.